Good afternoon and welcome back to yet another interesting conversation that we've got to you. A very important one indeed, with a very, very eminent personality, Sri G. Subbarao sir. So we welcome you to the session today, this afternoon, and thank you with all our hearts for being here for each one of us, and especially the aspirants who are greatly looking forward to the topic that you will be speaking upon today. Without much ado, I would like to introduce sir, who's a retired IAS officer of the 1965 batch. He's an author of some of the best-selling books in ethics, integrity, and aptitude. Sir was the chief secretary of the Gujarat government and also worked as chairperson Gujarat State Police Complaints Authority. He holds an MA in economics from the Andhra University, MA in rural development from the University of East Anglia, United Kingdom, and a postgraduate diploma in public administration from the IIPA, New Delhi. Sir, we welcome you here today and thank you once again for taking our time for us.
Okay, thank you.
Sir, you are speaking upon a very important topic today, which is the art of reading and answer writing for the UPSC exam, which is exactly all about the ball game. Every student, every aspirant is wanting to know a lot around this topic. So we've collated some questions, and the first one that we'd like to ask you, sir, is how should one approach reading while preparing for the UPSC exam before we talk about writing? So we'd like to speak about reading, sir.
You want to start with reading or with writing? With reading, is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that. I'll take 1 minute. Huh? Sorry for
sure,
the
sir. Not a problem. I think it's a very important aspect, sir, and especially reading and retaining what they read. So we felt we should begin with this.
That is true, actually. So, okay, I'm sorry I took a minute because I was, I thought we would start with writing, you know, that's how the questions were framed. So, good afternoon, friends. As Neha told you, you know, reading and writing skills are absolutely critical for the UPSC exams, or for that matter, for any exams where you have to write descriptive answers. But actually, so far, and also the reading skills and writing skills, both are also interlinked, actually. So first, I will tell you about the reading skills. And let me begin with what are the weaknesses in our reading style. So basically what happens, students tend to read casually, haphazardly, disorderly, desultorily, without full concentration. They read passively or inactively, without getting fully involved in what they are reading. So sometimes, you know, their attention also wanders. Their reading also tends to be shallow, superficial, and unsystematic. And basically what happens as a result is they are unable to absorb the study materials or understand them properly. So this is basically the problem. They fail to grasp and form up ideas in their mind in clear language on most topics. They have hazy and vague ideas. Often they are actually irrelevant, trivial, and repetitive also. So these ideas float in their mind, if I may say so, in the loose, long, and ungrammatical sentences. They reproduce such ideas in exam as they occur to them in answers. Actually, on reading skills, we have written a book. It is called Mastering Reading Skills for Civil Services. So I would recommend, if you want to, you please read that book. And now I will tell you something about reading systematically. Actually, I have written down the points because that it will be easier. No? Otherwise, sure, it would be.
Not a problem.
So your reading should be active, analytical, and organized. When you read about any topic, your aim should be to master it. That's very important. Do not read like you are reading a newspaper or a film magazine. Do not read from one end of a topic to the others. So then what happens? Then you will not be able to absorb. So what I will do, what is actually a systematic type of reading, right? So I will give a very simple example, because otherwise, you know, it will become very general. So I have taken a topic from a website of Ministry of External Affairs. It is on climate change, looking beyond the Paris Agreement. This is an article. You can think it as a topic you are reading, right? It is written by one Mr. Ajay Malhotra, who must be a foreign service officer, I suppose. So suppose you are reading a topic like this. First, what you have to do is you try to get an overview. So that means any topic is divided into subtopics. So the subtopics are usually mentioned as the subtitles or the side headings. So this topic actually is divided into 9 parts, right? I will quickly read out the 9 parts and the paragraphs in each subtopic.
Okay, sir.
So the first subtopic is History of UN Conferences and Agreements. So it has 6 paragraphs. The second subtopic is Disrupting Impact of Climate Change. So how climate change is affecting the world. The third is an agreement called UN Framework Convention of 1992. So this subtopic has 4 paragraphs. And the previous one I mentioned, subtopic, Disrupting Impact of Climate Change, that has 9 paragraphs. Then there are also another subtopic called Kyoto Protocol. It has one paragraph. Then Copenhagen and Cancun Conferences, 2 paragraphs. Then Paris Agreement on Climate Change 2015. It has 6 paragraphs. Then IPCC Special Report for 1.5 degrees of 2018. So this has 4 paragraphs. The COP at 24, Katrosi. So this has 1 paragraph. And finally, the last subtopic is the road ahead. And it has 11 paragraphs. So in all, this whole topic has 44 paragraphs, right? So whenever you are reading about any topic, this is only an example. It may be on fundamental rights. It may be on, say, it may be on, let us say, Article 370 or 35, whatever it is. So you have to first see the overall, how the topic has been divided into subtopics and the subtopics into paragraphs. So then what will happen? Then I will also give you a simple example of how you go about each paragraph. Of course, we will not have time to cover everything, but my idea is only to explain how you go through para by para. Say this para 2, you know, it discusses, this is actually the topic is disrupting impact of climate change. So it discusses things like anthropogenic greenhouse gases. So suppose you have read something like anthropogenic greenhouse gases. Then, you know, he also discusses what are their sources, what are those gases, what is their load at time, then how they are impacting different parts of the world. Then in another chapter, another paragraph, he discusses things like permafrost, glaciers, seawater becoming acidic. Then in another paragraph, he discusses scientific evidence and so on. Then he goes about pathogens. So what you have to do is that when you are going through each paragraph in this subtopic, you try to understand what is the main idea of that paragraph and what are the ancillary ideas with which it is supported. So you look at the main idea and the other ideas. And further, what you have to do, you have to, of course, ignore or overlook unimportant facts. Say, for example, there may be some trivial facts or some minor facts. There may be some examples. There may be some stories, some very general statements, and some transition sentences. So all these you can ignore while you are reading the paragraph. So then what happens in a paragraph, essentially, you are looking at what are the facts, what are the concepts, what are the terms which have been defined. Say, for example, anthropogenic greenhouse gases is a term. How is it defined? Then what are the trends over time? Say, for example, here he describes how global warming has increased over a period of time. Then a paragraph may also contain something about evidence or, you know, how to substantiate that the global warming is increasing. Then there may be some arguments. There may be some logic. So what you have to do is, when you are reading a paragraph, you have to pick up these things, right? So then what happens? Then the question of writing points. So when you are trying to learn a topic, what you should do is, you try to write down the points after you complete one subtopic, right? So then like this, you complete a second topic, then again write the topics, and like that you go on. So then this gives you a complete idea of how the material is organized and what are the main facts, details, arguments, and so on. So at the end of it, after you complete reading all the 44 paragraphs, then you again revise the paragraphs. So then you will have a clear-cut idea. So this is what I mean by organized, involved, active, analytical reading. Once you do it and cover a topic, write down the points, then you will follow it easily. Then you will not also forget it. And I would also say that whenever you are reading, normally you keep 2 or 3 hours. So in that 2 or 3 hours, ideally you should keep about, say, 2 to 2 hours, 15 minutes for reading, and the remaining time for writing points. This is how we should go about. So this, if you study like this, then you will have a clear understanding of the topic, and also you will not forget. You know, there is one question about how to retain the ideas. So if this, you follow this methodology, then you will not forget the ideas also. Here I would like to say one more point also. Sometimes students feel, you know, that they are not understanding something. So even this understanding is fairly simple, because these are all general studies and they are meant for not for specialists, actually. They are meant for generalists only. So whenever you do not understand a thing, there are two things. One is you try to see what this sentence is about, what is the subject. And if you do not understand any words, you look for the dictionary meaning. Say, for example, what is an anthropogenic gas? Anthropogenic gas means nothing but gases created because of human activities. So if you go like that, you will understand. You will know what is the structure of what you have read, what are the subtopics into which it has been divided, what are the how many paragraphs are there for each subtopic, and then what are the principal ideas. So this is how you should read.
A very holistic approach to reading and answering, sir. A very end-to-end cover is what you're suggesting, and I think it helps in retention also this way, since we are going point to point.
Yeah, yeah. And I would suggest one thing also. If you find that any topic is very difficult or technical, say, for example, say environment, science and technology, then the best thing is try to write it in the form of questions and answers. Suppose you take a paragraph, is it answering 2 or 3 questions? Write down question 1, answer, question 2, answer, question 3, answer. Of course, this may seem a little laborious, but preparation for UPSC is also a laborious task. And you don't have to read too many books also. You know, for each subject, you can follow one standard book and some references. And if you follow this method, and I would also suggest that you should keep separate notebooks for different topics. Say constitution, Indian economy, say independence movement, say and what you have, art and culture, like that, you know. If you go about it systematically, then you would be able to learn, organize the materials in your mind, and you will also be able to read out the answers. So, I mean, write out the answer. And another thing also I would like to mention at this stage. So whenever you come across any terms, concepts, doctrines, theories, you must make sure that you are able to express them clearly in your mind, and you should also write them on a piece of paper so that you will not have problem of expression in the examination hall. This is also another thing which you have to do. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. I think it must have opened up a lot of minds, and a lot of important suggestions have come. And I think this way a student would also understand its strengths, its weaknesses. You know, when you're maintaining different notebooks for different topics, you at least know where your strength lies and where you need more work to be done still. Yeah. So yeah, some very good suggestions made, sir. But right now we're discussing reading, and I think I can't undermine the importance of newspapers or important business magazines or other content which play a very important role. And we've been seeing teachers and students always focusing on the same. So, sir, some quick tips on how to make best use of this kind of material, newspapers, etc., and how to go about reading it.
Yeah, actually, I would say one thing. What I feel is, in my personal view, the importance of newspapers and magazines is sometimes overemphasized, you know. So basically what I would suggest is students can go to three sources, right? One is Press Information Bureau. You know, Press Information Bureau, they release materials on important developments, you know, policies, laws, etc. So that's one source. Then you can also read the Doordarshan News. That's a very good source of information. Then you can also follow Rajya Sabha TV for discussions, you know, critical discussions. And the fourth source I suggest is that you can go to the websites of the departments, so that you are able to get authentic materials, you know, from their websites. These are the sources I suggest, because what happens sometimes, newspapers contain excuse me for a minute, I've just
please.
You see, very often what happens, the newspapers and TV channels, you know, they go into things which are more topical and, you know, which have some ideological orientation and all that. So what I feel is that you either read straightforward textbooks or you go to the four sources I have suggested, and then that should give them enough background. But of course, one or two standard newspapers and magazines they can read.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure everybody's noted that down. We'll quickly move to the next very crucial segment, which can't be undermined at all. And it's been an understatement to actually say that writing is the backbone of civil exams, because it's much more. So how should one develop or learn the art of writing, sir? And we have a lot of questions around this to ask you, so we begin quickly with this, and also to find out that when should one start the answer writing practice, because some feel that that should be the first step and they should start doing it from day one. So kindly answer these two questions for us, sir.
Yeah. So I will take a little time in explaining, you know, the writing skills, what answer writing really involves. So basically, what answer, when you are writing an answer, you know, it's like a small narrative, right? 50 words, 100 words, 200 words, or 250 words, whatever it is. So it has three parts. Any answer has three parts. One is the content or matter of an answer, right? The second part is the structure of the answer. The third part is how you express yourself. So the language. So the content, form or structure, or language. So these are the three parts of the answer which you have to develop. So I will speak a little bit on that if you allow me. So content means the information, material, or points that constitute the answer, right? And the fundamental requirement is, I would like to emphasize that, that your answer should be tailored exactly to the question. So what is the question answering? You should try to answer it to the point, right? You should not beat about the bush or stray away from the thrust or focus of the question, right? If you stray from the question, what it means is that you are becoming irrelevant or that you are not really answering the question. So this is one point. So you should focus on exactly what the question is asking or examiner has in mind. So the one point. Then how to do this? You know, how do we do this, you know? So you have to determine the scope of the question or define the contours or the boundaries of the question. You have to delimit the question. So I'll give you a few examples. Say, suppose there is one question like, what is emotional intelligence? How can it be developed in people? How does it help an individual in taking decisions? Right? This is the question. So there are three parts. So you can write three paragraphs. The first part is a definition of emotional intelligence. The second part should be how to foster emotional intelligence. And the third part is how it helps in decision making. So if you do answer it in this way, then you have answered the question properly, right? Then the second question I'll take as an example. What is a digital signature? What does its authentication mean? Give various built-in features of a digital signature. So this also has three parts. The first part is you have to define digital signature. In the second part, you have to mention what it means. And the third part, of course, is what are its features, right? So basically what you have to do in answers like this, you should not repeat the points. So definition is one part, then the what is the meaning of authentication is another part, and what are the built-in features is another part. Then you would be answering the question correctly. Then I'll give another example. What is an FRP composite material? How are they manufactured? And how and what are their applications in aviation and automobile industry? So the first part is a definition of FRP material. The second part, you have to describe the process. And in the third part, you have to say how it is used in aviation and automobile. So you have to write only about aviation and automobile and not about other sectors, right? Then similarly, discuss the advantages and security implications of cloud hosting of services vis-a-vis in-house based hosting in government business. So here what you can do, you can write one introductory sentence about what cloud hosting means, one introductory sentence about how what is storage means, and then you can write the advantages and the security implications of hosting or storing government information in both these sources. So basically, you can perhaps conclude by saying that the government information, except for maybe defense, atomic energy, foreign affairs, or you know, space, can be stored in cloud. You know, this is how we can proceed. Now I will give you one more example. What are the challenges for women in India against time and space? What are the challenges for women in India against time and space? Now here the problem is, the question is a little vague. You know, what is the meaning or interpretation of challenges against time, challenges against space? So perhaps what the examiner means is that what are the problems they faced historically, that is in time, and what are the places they are facing geographically or in different social groups. So here you have to interpret the question and then give the answer. It's not a direct question. And finally, there is one more. I'll give the last example. Are we losing our local identity for global identity? Are we losing our global identity for global identity? So here also you have to interpret it. It simply means that because of globalization, are we losing our Indianness and adopting Western society's values, mores, and styles of living? And then you have to discuss the trends. Now, before winding up this, I will say two more points and leave it at that. You see, in some questions, especially in science and technology, environment, economics, constitution, law, etc., the questions have to be answered precisely and accurately. Whereas in other areas, you know, you can be a little more, there is a scope for free play. You know, this also you have to keep in mind.
So one answer and, does not fit all is what you're saying. So the rules will vary as per the subject.
Yes, particularly if you are writing about science, technology, and environment, you know, because there is a lot of science going into that, your answers have to be more accurate and precise. Whereas if it is history or sociology, it can be more general. You know? Right. That's what I'm saying. Then there is also sometimes what they are doing. They will give a quotation, and on that quotation, they will ask you a question. So see, when a quotation is given, what happened? They will write, elucidate, justify, discuss, or evaluate. Right? So you have to pay attention to that. You know, these words like elucidate, justify, discuss, or evaluate. So elucidate means you have to explain the meaning. Justify means you have to justify that statement. You should not argue against that question or the quotation. And discuss means you can go, you can mention both merits and demerits. So this is one aspect, you know, of the question. Can I take some more time? I hope we are not running out of time yet.
We have about 10 more minutes, sir, and a few more questions for you. We have some from the audience as well.
So I will then simplify, you know, I won't take too much time. So the second point is structure. Structure means you have to arrange the answers logically, right? It should not be random collection of sentences or random collection of points. And the third thing, you know, which is how you express yourself. So that means I will go quickly because, and I will allow them to ask the question. One is that your sentences should be grammatically correct, right? there should not be spelling mistakes. There should not be, you should write it not like you are writing a post on a social media, but in an academic style you have to write. So these are the basic things. Then you can now ask me the questions, because we have now only 10 minutes. So I would like to answer questions now.
Sure, sir. Don't worry. We'll take five more, because this is very crucial. We'd like to understand, you're throwing light on all the do's that are very important and must not be ignored. But I'm sure there are a lot of common mistakes that most of the UPSC aspirants make while writing the mains. So would you like to also highlight on what those common mistakes are and how they should be avoided, sir?
The common mistakes, as I have mentioned just now, you may not be answering the question exactly as it is worded, right? That is one problem, right? The second point is, you may be making too many errors of language. As I mentioned just now, grammatical errors, spelling mistakes, or your answer may not have a proper structure. And sometimes, when they ask you to make a distinction, for example, what is the difference between, say, honesty and integrity? Then you have to concentrate on the distinction, instead of just writing generally about that area. So these are some of the mistakes which they can avoid.
So since we're talking about structure of the answer, I think the introduction and conclusion also become very important. So, sir, what are the points that should be mentioned very clearly in the introduction and the conclusion of these answers?
So basically, what happens, if the question is in three parts, then you will be writing 50 words each, right? Or 60 words each. Then the introduction and conclusion will not be very important. But there are some questions where you may have to write one or two introductory lines and a concluding line also. Example, as I mentioned to you, in question about cloud, whether the government information should computers or in-house, then you have to write one introductory line about what in-house storage is and what cloud computing is. Then you can end with a conclusion of where to store that information. But otherwise, in most of the questions, I think, if they are very short questions, there will be no scope for introduction and conclusion. That is more important for essay, or where you are writing at least 300 words. Then you can write some introduction, one or two sentences, and a conclusion also should be one or two sentences, because the answers are very short. You should not consume too many sentences in giving the introduction and in giving the conclusion.
That is also important. True, sir.
Yeah.
So one question that I must ask, since we are discussing writing, students want to know that does handwriting also play a very important role in the UPSC mains? And is it true that good handwriting actually fetches more marks to some than the others? Is that right, sir?
I don't think so. But what is most important is handwriting should be legible. That means the examiner should be able to read it without much strain or difficulty. Suppose you cannot suddenly change your handwriting also. So what you can do is you try to form the letters and words distinctly. That is one care you can take. Then you separate your letters and words, and also you leave some distance between two words, and you write in a larger font, so that he is able to read it easily. That's the only thing. But otherwise, I don't think that a good handwriting will lead to more marks. but a very bad writing, handwriting may lose marks because she won't be able to read what
legible. You are saying. Yes, sir.
Yeah. True. Legibility is most important.
Thank you, sir, for answering that. Sir, do model answers provided by Coaching Institute help for main answer writing?
Actually, it depends, you know. If the model answers, two things are important. The model answers, if they are given for the UPSC questions, you know, previous year's papers have been answered, then by and large, it should be a useful guide. But they have to be written properly. That means they should have content should be proper, structure should be proper, and the language should be proper. These three are important. Then subject to that, you can use them actually.
Content, structure, and language is what you're highlighting, sir.
Yes.
Another student wants to is requesting if you could please suggest some sources where they can get access to some important government reports and editorials, sir.
Basically, they have to go to the concerned department's website. Suppose, say, you want to know about, say, climate change. Then the best website would be the website of Ministry of Environment and Forests. Right? If you want to know about Look East policy or Look West policy, or what is government's position on Afghanistan, then the best stage is to go to the Ministry of External Affairs and look at some speeches of, let us say, Foreign Minister Jayashankar. Or if you want to know something about COVID, the best source will be the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare.
So also some more questions are coming in, if you allow me to ask you.
Yeah, please.
Yes. Sir, they want to know that now that they have started answer writing, is it fine to self-evaluate those answers or should they enroll in answer writing courses to get some expert feedback on the answer quality, sir?
Actually, you know, what they should do basically is, there is no point in simply writing answers to one question after another. Suppose you write 10 answers to 10 questions and feel happy. What is most important is that after writing an answer, you know, they have to revise the answer. You know, as I told you, they have to look at the content, structure, and language and try to revise it twice. Write one draft, then a second draft, then a third draft, and then compare it with some model answer. That will help them greatly. And at a later stage, you know, they can show it to some teachers or tutors or guides. That's okay. But initially, they have to do it on their own.
So, sir, is it also important that they make their own notes or is it fine to read notes that somebody else has made, already created?
As I told you, it is 100% essential that they should make their notes. So whenever you read a topic, you must be simultaneously making notes. As I told you, divide the top, you know, that particular topic into subtopics. And at the end of each subtopic, that means after each subheading with 5 or 6 paragraphs, you write down the points, and that is the points you should note. And if you only read without taking points, that means you are not studying at all. But if you have some good notes of some students, you can use it for reference. But they should not substitute your own note-taking, because your own note-taking is part and parcel of your learning process, the process of absorbing the ideas and understanding the structure of a topic.
Thank you, sir. Okay. So another, I think, very common question on everybody's mind is, and this happens very often, we've seen, is that the scores in the main test series get stuck on a particular number, sir. And in that case, how can one enhance the answer writing skills to move that needle?
Actually, you know, as I told you, basically the mark which one gets, you know, it also depends on some fortuitous factors. Suppose the paper is such that many of the questions are known to him, right? He has prepared for them, then he will get more marks, right? And it also gets some kind of random effect also takes place. But the best way of, as you said, to raising the bar is to follow the procedure, you know, the procedure which you have suggested for answer writing, and go on trying to improve it. And also, I would like to say one thing which I did not tell because of the time constraint. They should read some good English novels and books. You know, I would suggest two sources.
Yes, please do. There,
one is, there is one, one sec, let me see where I have written. You know, there is an author called William Strunk.
William Strunk.
Strunk, S-T-R-U-N-K. Before that, William. So the name of the book is The Elements of Style. Elements of Style. It is written sometime in 1912 or 15, and it is available on the websites, actually. They type it, they will find it, and they can download it, and they must read this book, actually. It's only 120 pages, and it explains a great deal about how to write, you know, and it's very simple. He says you write simple sentences, write directly, make positive assertions, you know, things like that, and that if they can read that, it will be very helpful. And there is also one essay which they can again download. The title of the essay is Politics and the English Language. Politics and the English Language. The author is George Orwell. They can download it also and read. These two are excellent sources.
Sir,
if you want to
write, sir, please.
Sorry, I'll just. You know, there are some books on grammar I would like to recommend. Grammar books. Essential English Grammar, Intermediate English Grammar. Both these books are by an author called Raymond Murphy. Raymond Murphy. Another book called Advanced English Grammar by Michael Hewings. These are published by Cambridge University Press. So these are very good books because the chapters are very small. And at the end of each chapter, there are exercises. And at the end of the book, there are also answers. So it's very easy to learn grammar from this. And that will improve their score definitely. But this requires daily effort. They have to put in 1 or 2 hours every day on
that. Yes, absolutely. Agreed. Yes.
And one more thing also I would like to say. You see, another thing which is happening is that I don't know to what extent students are reading English stories and novels. So if you will permit me, I'll give you a few books which they can read. You know, one is by, so Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Many of you must have heard of Sherlock Holmes, right?
Yes.
So there are many books having this character Sherlock Holmes, say for example, Case Book of Sherlock Holmes, Memoirs of Sherlock Holmes, Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, The Return of Sherlock Holmes. So these can also be downloaded from website and then he can read them. And I would also request that they should read the stories of Agatha Christie also. So, and also novels like Jane Austen, Charles Dickens, J.K., you know, that Harry Potter series. And when you are reading these novels, what you should do is, say after you read 3 or 4 pages or 10 pages, You try to see how these sentences are constructed.
Sir.
How is the author writing these sentences? So you just go on watching, you know, that, okay, this is how this sentence is like that, you know, that will also help them greatly. It will improve their expression enormously.
That was a very holistic session, sir. I think end to end, everything that we've spoken about, structure, content, language, style of answering, sources, inclusion of newspapers, print media, electronic media, and students have also gained a lot. We've got a lot of questions that I could ask you. So thank you very much, sir. I mean, we are winding up the session, but this is a wealth that you're leaving us behind. You're leaving behind a lot of learning that has come about, and we really thank you for taking out time and sharing your experience and knowledge with all the aspirants here. So from the team of Kiran, thank you once again, very much,
and sorry because I had this, I couldn't
No problem, sir. We could hear you very well.
I hope it was audible and you could follow what I said. Okay?
Absolutely, sir. It was audible and very, very helpful, as we said.
The only problem is because of the time constraints, I couldn't cover everything. So I request them again to read that book, Reading Skills, Master Reading Skills for Civil Services. That will help them greatly.
Sure, sir.
Okay.
We'll do that. Thank you. Thank you once again, sir. And please take care.
Thank you.